Dear audience, welcome to the show Power Chat. In today's episode, we are going to discuss about United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organizations presence in Nepal. Its coordination with line ministries and civil society organizations. Joining us today is Mr. Christian Manhart, UNESCO Representative to Nepal. Please allow me to welcome him. Welcome to the show, Mr. Manhart.
Thank you very much. It's really a pleasure to see you again. We haven't met for quite a while now.
Yes. How have you been?
Fine. So it's very intense. So we got a lot of new funding, new projects. So in particular after the earthquake, and we have a lot of tasks here.
Since how long have you been here in the capacity of UNESCO representative for Nepal?
Yeah, time passes so quickly. I'm now here since almost 2 years.
Mm. And what is your impression over the diverse Nepal, you know, who have different languages here, different cultures, different geographic, landscapes? Have you visited some places and met people?
Yeah,
what is your impression?
Yeah, it's really amazing. I did, when I arrived here, I did not expect to find such a cultural scene, such a diversity of, as you say, languages or people and different cultures, religions. So I was very positively surprised. And I must say, from the first day when I arrived the country, I liked it. Mm-hmm. And I still like it very much. And I traveled a lot in this country, either professionally to see our projects, which are all over the country, but also privately, for example, by mountain bike. So I see many places.
So you have been to many places.
Yeah, around the Kathmandu Valley. And I was just last weekend, we did with some friends a mountain bike trip to Changu Narayan and then to Nagarkot. And it's amazing, the places where we stopped, people spoke different language, Nepali, Nevari, Tamang. Mm-hmm. So even we stopped at one place where the people spoke Tibetan language. Mm-hmm. So it's absolutely amazing.
Well, did you learn any language, including that of Nepali?
Ah, this is a weak point. I took Nepali lessons for almost a year, but it's very difficult, the Nepali language, and I'm not very good. So I understand a little bit now, but speaking, I really have difficulties. And all my friends here speak so good English that I almost have the feeling that I don't need it, what is totally wrong, of course, because I would be able to communicate in a much deeper manner if I spoke Nepali. So you remind me to take up my Nepali classes now during my vacation.
Well, Mr. Manhart, could you shed light on the UNESCO's working mandate in Nepal, its programs and activities and partnerships?
Yeah, we have a very wide mandate. You know, we are in charge of education, culture, media and communication, and science. So this really gives us a wide variety of different entry points into our work. We in the field of education, we help the government, for example, in the transition from a centralized education system towards decentralized, so the federal system. We now got also funding from COICA headquarters of almost $5 million for young women and girls education. So this we share with UN Women and with UNFPA. And we, because here is still a lot to be done for girls and women who much more drop out the school system than boys. In the field of culture, we are mainly in charge of the reconstruction of cultural heritage, not only reconstruction, but also restoration of building which still stand in order to prevent their collapse.
Mr. Manhart, I will come back to you on the issues of reconstruction and the disasters. As the name of the UNESCO suggests, it works in the areas of culture and education and scientific things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it is also known as intergovernmental agency. So for our audience, would you please explain on how UNESCO works? And what does intergovernmental agency mean, and how it makes different than other UN agencies to work with?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So we are an intergovernmental organization and a specialized organization of the UN system. So we are under the UN, but we have our own member states and our own budget. And we have, for example, two member states more than the United Nations. So United Nations, they have 193 and we have 195. So we have, in addition, Palestine and South Sudan as member states. And we, all these member states, they have a mandatory budget which goes in our so-called regular budget, which is, let's say, half of our total budget. And then the other half are extra budgetary contributions which come from member states, but also from foundations or private people. Because our regular budget is mainly for the functioning of the organization. We have also 50 field offices all over the world. And the headquarters of UNESCO is in Paris, where I have been posted before coming here to Nepal, actually. And our member states, they elect an executive board of 58 countries from the different regions of the world. So there's an equitable distribution of the different regions in our executive board. And the executive board meets 2 to 3 times per year in Paris in order to decide on our programs. And also to judge us whether we have done well or not so well. And they tell UNESCO what we have to do. So it's really, we work for our member states. And Nepal actually is member of the executive board at the moment. So Nepal has a very important role to play in UNESCO. And we have then our major organ, which is the General Conference, and the General Conference meets every second year. So the next one will be in October and November 2017.
So you mean the countries have a shared partnership with the UNESCO by principle, since they are the members?
Absolutely. And they have to decide on all our projects. So UNESCO proposes, but our member states, they have to approve what we do. So we do this in a 2 years program, where we make a plan what budgets are assigned to which activities, and our member states every 2 years vote on this.
Would you also explain on the UNESCO clubs and the UNESCO commission? There are many clubs associated with UNESCO. Also there is UNESCO commission, where the authorities from the government they work with.
We have many networks. So so our main networks are the member state networks. So this is the national commission of each country to UNESCO. So we have this in Nepal, where the national commission is under the Ministry of Education. In other countries could be Foreign Ministry or even Ministry of Culture. So, but mostly it's Ministry of Education, because education is our main task. And then, in addition to the UNESCO Commission, we also, each member state has a delegation. So in Paris, we have a delegation of Nepal, whereas the head of this delegation is the Nepali ambassador to France, and he's also the ambassador to UNESCO. So our headquarters works very closely with the delegation, and I here in our field office in Kathmandu, I work very closely with the Nepali UNESCO Commission. And then we have also the UNESCO clubs. So that's an association with many clubs, and we also work with them here in Nepal. There are more than 100 UNESCO clubs, actually. We also have an
Of different groups,
of different people. Different people, youth,
professions,
Students, adults. So all kinds of clubs can apply to this, to become a UNESCO club.
So structurally, UNESCO has a very local and regional presence through clubs and commissions.
Yeah, we have this, but we do not have a direct influence on these on these clubs. We also have the for example, the UNESCO Associated Schools. Mm-hmm. It's a network of 7,000 schools all over the world, which are associated schools to UNESCO, and we also have some of them here in Nepal.
Mm-hmm. And how do you work with the civil society organizations, also known as non-governmental agencies?
Yeah, so we are of course obliged firstly to work with the government as an intergovernmental organization. So if I want to do an activity here in Nepal, I need for it the approval of the government. And then when I have got the approval and the support of the government for an activity, then we work with the civil society. So for us it is very important to include the local communities. For example, we work in Sanku, mm-hmm. we help Sanku for the reconstruction, and we work with all the different organizations. So we work with the municipality, but also with the Sanku Reconstruction Committee, with the Friends of Sanku Committee, and with the youth clubs in Sanku. We bring all them together. Or in Swayambu, for example, we work with the Federation of the Management of mm-hmm. of Swayambu site, but also with the priests
for the protection of cultural
for the protection of cultural heritage. Mm-hmm. And in education also we work with the, for example, with the learning centers mm-hmm. all over the countries, and we also support them financially.
So in the area of education, your focus is in infrastructure or to the human resources, capacity building of the schools or teachers?
Very clearly it's capacity building. So for infrastructure building, we do not have enough funding. So mm-hmm. these are other really donor agencies. So we, UNESCO, we are not a donor agency, we are a technical assistance agency, and try to build up the capacity in the country in the different fields.
Well, UNESCO is also known as the only UN mandated agency working for the promotion of freedom of expression.
Absolutely.
What are your programs here in Nepal, and how do you work to promote free expression or freedom of opinion?
Yeah, we had a very successful project, for example, for safety of journalists, mm-hmm. where we worked closely with the Human Rights Commission. Mm-hmm. We also worked for the impunity, mm-hmm. or against the impunity, actually, mm-hmm. of crimes against journalists, because we see that most of the crimes which were committed against journalists were not investigated, and the people not brought to court. So we didn't in the country people who did these crimes were not even identified. And then also one of our struggles is against the self-censorship of journalists, mm-hmm. because we see their journalists here in Nepal have a lot of pressures, political pressures, but also from business, for example, and we want to work for free media in mm-hmm. Nepal. So there's still a long way to go, of course.
Okay, but you are working in the different areas, from culture to education to media, and we noticed a big disaster last year, the earthquake, and one of the major areas of UNESCO, as you mentioned, is the protection of cultural heritage. How did you support to the process of rebuilding of Nepal, especially the cultural heritage sites, world heritage site that UNESCO enlist with?
Yeah, this is one of our tasks, and we have here in Kathmandu 7 world heritage sites. So it counts as one world heritage site on the list, but it has 7 independent world heritage zones, and most of them were heavily damaged during the earthquake. And we formed directly after, so 5 days after the first earthquake, we had a coordination meeting with the Department of Archaeology and with all other stakeholders, so mm-hmm. with representatives from all these sites, with Nepali experts, international mm-hmm. experts, everyone who was there, in order to evaluate the situation.
You mean you engaged in the monitoring at the beginning?
Exactly. So the beginning was just an assessment mm-hmm. of mm-hmm. the damage, and then drawing up priority list where we had to intervene immediately. So, for example, we provided protection and shelter for many buildings which had lost their roofs or the roofs were heavily mm-hmm. damaged, in order to protect them from the rain. We also protected in Soyambu, for example, the south slope with tarpaulins mm-hmm. from the rain. And then we set up a list of priority and did active fundraising. So we got a lot of funding from very different sources. For example, the government of Flanders, mm-hmm. government of Italy, of Japan. We got a lot of funding also from China, mm-hmm. From foundations there in China. And we can work with this money. We did then in a second phase mm-hmm. the together with the Department of Archaeology protection of monuments which were still standing but at risk of collapsing. So mm-hmm. And then
what is the recent status of the World Heritage sites? Are they reconstructed already?
Yeah,
you see in the process too.
You see here in the Kathmandu Valley that reconstruction is extremely slow, not only of the private building but also of heritage buildings.
What, so in your observation, is the main reason behind slow reconstruction
process? For cultural heritage, it's really much more complicated, even as for private buildings. Mm-hmm. One reason is the slow decision-making process in the country. Mm-hmm. So there's no clear decision-making. Mm-hmm. You know, we need for every project the approval of the mm-hmm. government. So mm-hmm. if we get funding mm-hmm. from a donor for the restoration of a certain monument, we have to make a plan of operation which is signed by UNESCO and by the government. And there's no clear decision-making whether this is the Department of Archaeology, the Minister of Culture, the Minister of Finance. Mm-hmm. So this takes very long time. For example, if I want to examine a brick from a collapsed monument to see the strength of this brick, whether we can reuse the bricks or whether we have to make new ones, I have to write a letter to the Department of Archaeology, and then it can take 1 month mm-hmm. until I get a reply from them mm-hmm. that I can use the brick. Of course, I get always a positive reply. Mm-hmm. We have a good cooperation, but it takes very long time. Mm-hmm. And then the other difficulties for heritage sites is you cannot just reconstruct it. You must see what is under the ground. You must examine the foundations. Also, it took me 2 months to get the authorization to make archaeological excavations of the foundations of the three Durbar squares in Patan, mm-hmm. Bhaktapur, and Kathmandu mm-hmm. to see what is the state of the foundations, to know whether we have to reinforce them or whether we can directly build on them. And then we have to, for example, on Kathmandu Durbar Square, we had to find all the carved wooden beams. Mm-hmm. We had 16 so-called dumping sites where mm-hmm. they were put with the rubble and all this. You cannot imagine, you know, they were just put there mm-hmm. often by bulldozers. And in the flow of this work, we even identified more dumping sites. So we have now 23 dumping sites from which we take huge amounts of very precious carved salwood beams. Some of them are extremely big and very delicately carved. We have made an inventory because they were all mixed up. So to which temple and to which part of the temple the beam belongs, and whether we can reuse it or we have to redo. And this is done by Nepali specialists who were engaged by UNESCO. So we pay for it.
Well, Mr. Manhart, it's really frustrating to see that, you know, development things are always process oriented. And in your observation, what is the response from the public in the activities that UNESCO engages with, especially in the areas of reconstruction and the building of cultural heritage sites?
So from the public, we have an extremely positive reply. So mm-hmm. all the local communities with which we work mm-hmm. are extremely motivated. They want to do something, and they want to work with us, and they really help us a lot. So for us, it's a big asset to work with the local communities.
Well, we are coming to the end of the show. What is your impression over the overall development of Nepal? What do you think are the crucial challenges before Nepal in the sector of development, be it infrastructure or the human development?
It's a very difficult question. So I'm not sure whether I'm the right person to give the reply. So
from the perspective of your work.
So what I have seen is that Nepal needs stability. This means political stability, which we do not have at the moment. We, for example, in the 2 years I'm here, I'm already at the third minister of culture. There might be even now a new government. So we hope that this new government will be formed very quickly and will be a stable government. And then also the lack of infrastructure in this country. So I have worked in many other countries. I have never seen a capital where many roads are not blacktopped. So where you have during rainy season you have to go through deep mud holes, where cars get blocked. Look at the so-called highway which goes direction Pokhara. Just to leave Kathmandu is a very difficult enterprise with a car. A country which has this huge potential as Nepal, hydropower.
Why do you mean the resources are not properly utilized here?
Yeah, we have all these long power cuts here in Kathmandu, in the capital, but there's a huge potential for hydropower which is not yet used. I'm sure it will be used one day, and I hope that this happens very 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 quickly. And then, for example, pollution. Why is there no control on extremely polluting vehicles in Kathmandu? And I saw now in the 2 years I'm here, I saw that the pollution, the air pollution situation in Kathmandu got really worse in 2 years already. So why are people forced to walk in the city with masks to breathe? So I think with rather simple measures, the air pollution could be brought down. There's of course part of the air pollution which comes from the terrain, which comes even from up from India, and so there's a certain level you can't change. But there's a level you can change. I have in my neighborhood somebody who burns tires almost every evening, polluting all the area, and this is allowed. So you even can't send the police to this person because he has the right to do this on his ground. Why do the people burn their waste in their gardens? This doesn't happen in other capitals.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Manhart, for your time. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. It was really a pleasure to talk to you and to come back to see you.
Dear audience, we have come to the end of the show. Keep watching us. See you next week. Namaste.